Naturally, you do what any neurologist would do after hearing worse headache of life with emesis. You get a non-contrast head CT. And here it is. There is extensive hyperdensity in the sylvian fissures, interpeduncular cisterns, and interhemispheric fissure. These hyperdensities are within the subarachnoid space. So, this is diffuse subarachnoid hemorrhage. This patient has a right supraclinoid ICA aneurysm that likely ruptured and caused the hemorrhage. We diagnose aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. If you're not familiar with how it's typically managed, here is a short version.
First, it's a good idea to gauge how sick a patient with subarachnoid hemorrhage is. One useful way to assess the clinical severity of subarachnoid hemorrhage is the 5-point Hunt and Hess classification scale. Mild headache in alert and oriented patients gets 1 point. 2 points are for patients who have moderate to severe headache with nuchal rigidity, but do not yet have any focal neurological deficits. Cranial nerve palsies are allowed here. Cranial nerves run through the subarachnoid space and can be irritated by the decomposing blood. Hunt and Hess 3 is a lethargic, confused patient who is showing mild focal neurological deficits. If that patient becomes more stuporous and difficult to awaken, and the focal deficits become more severe, the score would be 4. And the sickest patients, the patients with the highest mortality, are Hunt and Hess 5. They're comatose and have signs of severe neurological impairment, like posturing.
The first order of business is to prevent rebleeding by aggressively controlling the blood pressure and correcting coagulopathy when present. Shortly thereafter, an aneurysm must be secured. That usually involves an invasive cerebral angiogram and endovascular or surgical intervention. The next step is to prevent secondary injury. And a significant mechanism for this secondary injury in patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage is hydrocephalus. Blood in the subarachnoid space clots and prevents efficient CSF circulation. Hydrocephalus may require intracranial pressure monitoring and diversion of cerebrospinal fluid flow. Patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage are quite unstable, so they are usually managed in the intensive care unit setting. Things can change very quickly. In the next days to weeks, decomposing blood in the subarachnoid space may also irritate the walls of blood vessels, which travel through that space. This irritation may result in vasospasm. And where there's spasm, there's potential for decreased blood flow and delayed cerebral ischemia. The ultimate goal of aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage management is to prevent recurrence. That involves surveillance for future aneurysms, risk factor modification, and repair of unruptured aneurysms where appropriate.